I apologize because maybe some of you are looking and saying, I heard that before. I will take credit for it. We had a mishap in the back in the DVD room, and we cannot find the master tape of this sermon. And I'm getting requests for it, and I'd like to have a full set if possible. So as I thought about it, preparation for rain, you know, we're all looking at the thought of latter rain and the fact that it's coming soon. So I don't think we can ever hear too much about it. So I thought, well, we'll just go ahead and do it again. So let's kneel for prayer. Father in heaven, we are grateful for your amazing grace that you have shown each one of us this last week in safety as we've traveled, and provision for all our needs, and for being a very present help in times of trial. We thank you for your grace this morning. We pray for the Holy Spirit to guide us, to speak to us today as we contemplate preparation for rain. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I'd like to look at a few Bible promises as we get started this morning. They're all going to be from the Old Testament Gospel book. Can somebody tell me which book that is? He was called the Gospel Prophet. Isaiah. That's right, Rita. Isaiah. There's so many beautiful promises in the book of Isaiah. Let's start with Isaiah chapter 51, verse 3. Isaiah 51 and verse 3. Bible says, for the Lord shall comfort Zion. Zion, of course, are those who are professing to follow Christ. The Lord shall comfort Zion. He will comfort all her waste places. He will make her wilderness like Eden, her desert like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness shall be found therein, thanksgiving and the voice of melody. Beautiful promise. God will take our wilderness that looks barren and without hope, and he will build and plant hope for his children. Love that promise. Another one on Isaiah 49, 14 to 16. Isaiah 49, 14 to 16, the Bible says, but Zion said, the Lord has forsaken me. My Lord has forgotten me. Can a woman forget her sucking child, that she should not have compassion on the son of her womb? Yea, they may forget, yet will I not forget thee. Behold, I have graven thee upon the palms of my hands. Thy walls are continually before me. History has recorded times when women have forsaken and turned away from their children whom they have nursed. But in the most touching portrayal, God says, they may forget, but I will not forget. That's very precious, very precious. Finally, one other one. In Isaiah chapter 45. Isaiah chapter 45. Starting with verse 22 through 24. It says, look unto me and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God and there is none else. I have sworn by myself, The word is gone out of my mouth in righteousness and shall not return. That unto me every knee shall bow, every tongue shall swear. And then verse 24, surely shall one say, in the Lord have I righteousness and strength. Love those promises. In the Lord we have righteousness. In the Lord we have strength. Reminds me of the statement in Desire of Ages on the temptation or the victory. It's the temptation, the chapter called The Temptation. It says, when assailed by temptation, look not to circumstances or to the weakness of yourself, but look to the power of God's word. All its strength is yours. So we can look to the righteousness of Christ to do for us that which we cannot do. Praise God this morning for that awesome, awesome truth. Well, this morning, we're looking in 1 Kings chapter 18, preparation for rain. The backdrop, apostasy had paid a heavy price. Many had died. Crops were non-existent. Hope was well nigh gone among God's professed people. God sent a man. He called the people to repentance. He prayed and fire fell from heaven. But still there was no rain. You know, folk, of course, we live in affluent, rich in natural resources, plenty of rain in Florida, but it's not the case over much of America. I know when I was out west, they're having to watch their water intake in California. They're in a horrible drought. So, you know, we watch natural disaster all about us where God is trying to call us to repentance. Of course, in 1 Kings chapter 18 and verse 39, when the fire fell from heaven in the days of Elijah, the Bible says when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces and they said, the Lord, he is the God, the Lord, he is the God. So after a period of 3.5 years, no rain, no crops, animals dying, people dying, a completely destructive and devastating situation. Finally, the people responded. Finally, they acknowledged the authority of the God of heaven. And it was then that God began to move. Prophets and Kings, page 148. It says, the Lord abhors indifference and disloyalty in a time of crisis in his work. The whole universe is watching with inexpressible interest the closing scenes of the great controversy between good and evil. The people of God are nearing the borders of the eternal world. What can be of more importance to them than that they be loyal to the God of heaven? All through the ages, God has had his moral heroes. He has them now. Those who, like Joseph, Elijah, and Daniel, are not ashamed to acknowledge themselves his peculiar people. His special blessing accompanies the labors of men of action, men who will not be swerved from the straight line of duty, but who with divine energy will inquire who is on the Lord's side. Men who will not stop merely with the inquiry, but who will demand that those who choose to identify themselves with the people of God shall step forward and reveal unmistakably their allegiance to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Such men make their wills and plans subordinate to the law of God. Fidelity to God is their motto. Well, Elijah was calling God's people to take a stand. I think God is calling us, all of us, to take stands as well. all of us. Now, the people on Mount Carmel that bowed before God, that said, "The Lord, He is God," what did they say in those words? Well, Prophets and Kings, page 153, the Bible, Ellen White says, "The people on the mount prostrate themselves in awe before the unseen God. They dare not continue to look upon the heaven-sent fire. They fear that they themselves will be consumed, and convicted of their duty to acknowledge the God of Elijah as the God of their fathers, to whom they owe allegiance, they cry out together as with one voice, 'The Lord, He is the God. The Lord, He is the God.'" With startling distinctness, the cry resounds over the mountain and echoes in the plain below. At last, Israel is aroused, undeceived, and penitent. Now this right here, folk, this right here made possible the blessing of God upon His people. They were aroused, they were undeceived, and they were penitent. At last the people see how greatly they have dishonored God. The character of Baal worship, in contrast with the reasonable service required by the true God, stands fully revealed. The people recognize God's justice and mercy in withholding the dew and the rain until they have been brought to confess His name. They are ready now to admit that the God of Elijah is above every idol. You know, this reminds me, this week I was chatting on the phone with somebody, and the person's family was in a shambles. He was in the process of a divorce, and in that process he was living with another woman. Oh, it gets a lot worse than this, folk. It was unbelievable. The gentleman's life was tied to this woman he was living with, and his job was connected with her. They were in a job together selling something, and he was using her car. And he called me on the phone. And he started off the way so many people do. He said, "I've watched your YouTube videos, and what a blessing." And I said, "Well, praise God." And so he started going through this story with me. And when he came to the end, he said, "What should I do? What should I do?" I said, "For starters, I said, you need to leave that house. You cannot be in an adulterous relationship while you are still legally married. You cannot be living with another woman. You need to leave that house." He said, "But I don't have a car. And my job is connected to being in that home." I said, "You heard what I said." Because, and it goes right back to what Elijah was saying here, or what Ellen White was saying about the experience of the professed people of God. How could God bless His people when they were doing things they knew were wrong? How could He? He couldn't. He can't. And so I told this guy, he said, my job is collapsing, my business is collapsing. I said, "How can you expect God to work in your life and to bless you if you are doing that which you know is wrong? How can you?" He said, "But I've been teaching this woman that I'm with, I've been teaching her about God, and she would be devastated." And I said, what God have you been teaching her about? I said, you have not been teaching her about the God of heaven. You've been teaching her that to live in an adulterous relationship, that there will be a blessing from God. I said, you need to leave immediately. If you don't have a car, if you don't have a job, whatever it is. But I said, you need to leave that relationship. He said, well, thank you. And we hung up. Folk, same thing happened here. God could not bless Israel with rain until there was penitence. Until there was an acknowledgement, I've done this wrong, I know it's wrong, I want to change. I want God's power in my life. And until that happens, there cannot be the blessing of God on anything that is outside of the confines of his law. Can't be. And that was the case with ancient Seventh-day Adventism. You know, the other day, there's a radio program I'm on every other Wednesday out of California. And Seventh-day Adventists at large are, every morning at 7 and every evening at 7, they are encouraged to collectively pray around the world for, guess what? The latter rain of the Holy Spirit. The latter rain of the Holy Spirit. And last time or a couple of times before, I said, you know, to pray for the latter rain when we are living in sin, telling people they can be saved in sin, rejecting the spirit of prophecy, and involved in spiritual formation, I said, folk, the blessing of God will not rest on his professed people when there is sin in the camp. Now, for some reason, they allow me to stay on the program, but I don't know how much longer that will last. But folk, the issue here is penitence brought blessing, and it will again. At last, the people saw how greatly they had dishonored God. The people recognized God's justice and mercy in withholding the dew and the rain until they have been brought to confess his name. Now, folk, you know, we get this idea in our world today, well, if I just confess Jesus' name, then I'm saved and God will bless me. No, in confession is involved turning away. The Bible says in Proverbs 28, he that covers his sins shall not prosper. But whosoever confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy. So folk, confession that says, oh, I believe in Jesus, and oh, yes, he's my Savior. No, that means nothing unless there is a decided change in the life. True repentance is seen in the story of David. We have many false forms. You had Balaam, the guy who had a donkey talk to him. When Balaam was confronted with his sin, Balaam said, I've sinned. I've done wrong. But once the angel left, what did Balaam do? He kept right on the path that he had been on before. Saul, the first king of Israel, when Saul was pointed out his sin, when he took back in 1 Samuel 15 some of the animals from the Amalekites that Samuel had told him, kill them all. And Samuel said, Saul, what are you doing? You've got these animals here. God said, destroy them. Destroy all the Amalekites. And when Samuel pointed out his sin, what did Saul say? He said, oh, I'm sorry. I apologize, I've sinned. And once Samuel left, what did Saul do? He kept right on the same pathway. Judas did the same thing in Matthew 27, verse 4. Judas said, I've sinned in that I've betrayed the world's Redeemer. But folk, there was no change. There was no desire to make things right. So there's false penitence in Scripture. And there's true penitence. And David in Psalms 51 shows true repentance. Notice what the book Steps to Christ says. The prayer of David after his fall illustrates the nature of true sorrow for sin. His repentance was sincere and deep. There was no effort to palliate his guilt, no desire to escape the judgment threatened that inspired his prayer. David saw the enormity of his transgression. He saw the defilement of his soul. He loathed his sin. It was not for pardon only that he prayed, but for purity of heart. He longed for the joy of holiness to be restored to harmony and communion with God. You see, folk, there are multitudes today in our world that when they go to God, they pray to be forgiven so that they can turn around and keep doing the same thing that they know is wrong that they're asking forgiveness for. And that's not true repentance. It's not. David's repentance involved forgiveness and purity of heart to be restored to harmony with the principles of God's government. And of course, the other aspect of forgiveness is, well, Lord, please forgive me, but it was so-and-so's fault anyway. It wasn't my fault. Folk, that's not true repentance. That's the response of Adam and Eve when God came to them and said, what have you done? And they said, oh, well, you know, Adam said, well, it was the woman's fault. And then Eve was asked, and Eve, what did you do? And Eve said, well, it was the devil's fault. Folk, true repentance involves no excuses, no pointing of fingers. It is me. I'm the problem. I did wrong. That's necessary for true repentance. Now, the only other time in the Bible when rain fell, spiritually speaking, was when the disciples were praying for the early rain to fall. And notice in Acts of the Apostles, page 36, as the disciples waited for the fulfillment of the promise of the Holy Spirit, they humbled their hearts in true repentance and confessed their unbelief. That, folk, will bring rain. That will bring rain right there. And it did. It did. How about us today? Ancient Adventism on Mount Carmel would never have seen rain until there was genuine repentance and an acknowledgement of the true and living God. Adventism in the first century saw the early rain because of their confession and repentance. Today, we will never see rain until we repent of our sins, confess our inability to obey the Lord, and in humility rely upon His power to overcome. Only then will the rain fall. So for the physical rain to fall, for spiritual rain to fall, the power of the Holy Spirit, there must be true confession of sin. There must be. If there isn't, not going to happen. Now, there was something else that had to take place as well. 1 Kings 18 and verse 40. The Bible says, Elijah said to them, "Take the prophets of Baal, let not one of them escape." And they took them, and Elijah brought them down to the brook Kishon and slew them there. Wow. Sounds like Elijah was full of hate, doesn't it? Sounds like Elijah was a mean man. Was he? Folk, when there is apostasy and there is somebody standing against it, somebody's going to fall. Somebody's going to fall. The prophets of Baal were leading the people into sin and garbage and filth and were turning people from the true God and His commandments. And Elijah said, "You get those guys. They have refused to repent. They saw fire come from the sky. They have refused to repent." And Elijah said, "They deserve to die." That's what he said. Boy, we can't even send out a flyer. I can't even say something on a radio program nowadays. I can't even stand in a church and speak ill of apostate doctrine without somebody saying, "Oh, he's intolerant. He's hateful. He's persecuting the Lord's anointed." Folk, were these prophets of Baal, had they been anointed? Well, they were anointed with an evil spirit. But what did Elijah do to their apostasy? Elijah said, "Enough is enough." Now, how would we refer to Elijah today? To stand up for something today, folks, you're on a hit list. You're a wanted person, as Elijah was in his day. The Baal prophets were unrepentant and unwilling to acknowledge the power of God. They would ever continue to spread a cancer over God's professed people. They must go, and so Elijah had them slain. So what do we do with men in Seventh-day Adventism that are teaching false doctrines? You know, people like Ted Wilson, who says that the Sabbath, or the mark of the beast, is any other day of the week other than the Seventh-day Sabbath. Folk, that's putrid. That's garbage. And, you know, he's rewriting the great controversy so that huge chunks of that book are no longer there. So what do you do with somebody that is leading God's people away from the truths we've been given as a people? You say, "Are you suggesting that we take him down to the brook Kishon and have him killed?" Folk, the guy should be removed from his job. He should be removed from a position of authority. Folk, this idea that we keep people in and if anybody says anything about them or against what they're preaching, that you're intolerant and you're hitting the Lord's anointed, that is ridiculous. It's ridiculous. It's time that some of these men were removed from their positions of authority. If you don't stand for something, you will fall for anything. Let's face it, folk. You know, if you stand up for something today, then you have pot shots thrown at you and you're a bad person. Well, it's time we stand for something. Because nobody is standing for anything. It's time we stand for something. Because if we don't stand for something today, then we're going to fall for anything. I guarantee you, you'll fall for anything, folk. And there's so many things out there to fall for. There's so many false teachings amongst us, it's pathetic. The priests of Baal witnessed with consternation the wonderful revelation of Jehovah's power. But in their discomfiture and in the presence of divine glory, they refused to repent of their evil doings. See, folk, when we excuse people that are doing wrong and teaching wrong, when we support them, when we say, oh, it's okay, they're the Lord's anointed, they can do whatever they want to do, they can say whatever they want to say, folk, we're excusing people in wrongdoing. We're excusing them. Elijah did not excuse them. He dealt with them. They would still remain the prophets of Baal. Thus, they showed themselves ripe for destruction. That repentant Israel may be protected from the allurements of those who have taught them to worship Baal, Elijah is directed by the Lord to destroy these false teachers. Now, the worship of Baal was sun worship, folk, that Baal was the creator. The worship of Baal was the rejection of the Lord Jesus Christ as the creator of heaven and earth. And so people today like Joel Osteen or Joyce Myers or T.D. Jakes or, you know, Hal Lindsey or John Hagee or all these guys that are encouraging sun worship. Folk, great controversy says that one day they will be destroyed. They will be destroyed. The anger of the people has already been aroused against the leaders in transgression. When Elijah gives the command, take the prophets of Baal, they are ready to obey. They seize the priests, take them to the brook Kishon. And there, before the close of the day that marked the beginning of decided reform, the ministers of Baal are slain. Not one is permitted to live. Folk, in that time, God did that to bring about salvation to his people by the destruction of these false teachers. When false teachers are destroyed in the future for turning people away from the truth of God, folk, at that time, there will be no salvation in it because that will be after the close of probation. And those ministers will be slain. And they will be slain by those whom they have deceived. Here it was an attempt to save. Then it will simply be for destruction. Same thing happened in Exodus chapter 32, verses 26 to 28. You remember the story about Aaron? Aaron told the people to bring their gold and their jewels and their necklaces and their rings. And Aaron said, "We'll bring all that to me and I'll throw it into the fire." And Moses came down and he said, "Aaron, what happened?" And Aaron said, "Well, don't get mad, Moses. I just threw the stuff into the fire and out popped this calf." Folk, we can say some really dumb things. We can say some really dumb things when we're trying to justify ourselves. Some really dumb things. So what did Moses tell the people in the camp about this golden calf? What did Moses say? He said, "Who's on the Lord's side? Who does not go along with this?" And the sons of Levi gathered themselves together to him. And Moses said to them, "Thus saith the Lord God, put every man his sword by his side and go in and out from gate to gate throughout the camp. Slay every man his brother and every man his companion and every man his neighbor. And the children of Levi did according to the word of Moses, and there fell of the people that day about 3,000 men. Boy, was Moses a bad guy. Now, I know in certain vernacular, in certain cultures, it's okay to be bad. But in this case, Moses, ooh, what a cruel fellow. He's killing people? Why did those 3,000 die, folk? Because they were the ringleaders in this apostasy. And when Moses said, who is on the Lord's side? Who wants to denounce this? Those 3,000 said, this is of God right here. This is what God wants right here. And Moses said, cut them to shreds. And they were cut to shreds, folk. And it's going to happen again. It's going to happen again. This idea that when somebody stands up for something, for anything, if they stand up for something and what they're standing up for is right and true, that they become the bad guy? Folk, we've got to rearrange our thinking processes. Moses was right. Elijah was right. And if we stand for right today, we're right. And don't be justifying people when they're in the wrong. The Israelites had been guilty of treason against a king who had loaded them with benefits and whose authority they had voluntarily pledged themselves to obey. That the divine government might be maintained, justice must be visited upon the traitors. Justice visited upon traitors? No, we want to excuse them. We want to justify wrong. We want to say, oh, no, leave them alone. They didn't mean that. Hogwash, folk. Hogwash. Justice demands. Even here, God's mercy was displayed. While he maintained his law, he granted freedom of choice and opportunity for repentance to all. There you go. There's that word. Everybody had a chance to say, man, that was dumb. Why did I get involved in that? Why did I do it? And then to turn away. Only those who were cut off who persisted in rebellion. It was necessary that this sin should be punished as a testimony to surrounding nations of God's displeasure against idolatry. By executing justice upon the guilty, Moses, as God's instrument, must leave on record a solemn and public protest against their crime. As the Israelites should hereafter condemn the idolatry of the neighboring tribes, their enemies would throw back upon them the charge that the people who claimed Jehovah as their God had made a calf and worshipped it in Horeb. Then, though compelled to acknowledge the disgraceful truth, Israel could point to the terrible fate of the transgressors as evidence that their sin had not been sanctioned or excused. You know, folk, if we as a people today can excuse wrong in people in high places, if we can excuse somebody for teaching false doctrines, if we can do that, then why can't we excuse somebody outside of Seventh-day Adventism? Why can't we do that? Why can't we excuse when the apostate Protestant churches and Roman Catholicism say, you know, God's law has been changed. We now need to keep the first day of the week. Why can't we justify them too? Why can't we? Folk, it's very dangerous to justify sin in ourselves, and it's very dangerous to justify sin in somebody else. And if we make excuses in others, in ourselves, then eventually we will excuse this world for telling us to embrace sun worship. Scary, scary material. Phinehas, of course, in Numbers 25, was the man who took the javelin when there was immorality among God's people. The leader in the chief house of Simeon took a Midianite woman, took them right through the tent of Israel, went to their tent, were having relations, and Phinehas took a javelin and pinned them to the earth. And folk, the Bible says that God blessed Phinehas for what he did. And you say, oh, I'm sure glad God's not that way anymore. I don't worship the God of the Old Testament. I worship the God of the New Testament. Folk, the God of the Old and the God of the New is the same. There is still punishment for wrong. And God will have a people or individuals who will still determine and say, right is still right and wrong is still wrong. And the blessing of God will rest upon those who will stand for what is right. Elijah, Moses, Phinehas, just to name a few, were used as God's instruments to punish and slay apostasy. What about those today who are seeking to destroy Adventism? You have women's ordination, you have spiritual formation, you have people saying we need to obey whatever the state tells us. You have to follow what the church says, not what the Bible teaches, but follow your leaders. Now, folk, those amongst us today that are teaching these things must be removed, or the latter rain spiritually will never fall on apostate Adventism. It never will, folk. It never will. Phase 3, to bring rain. 1 Kings 18, verse 42, the Bible says, Ahab went up to eat and to drink. Elijah went up to the top of Carmel. He cast himself down upon the earth and put his face between his knees. Elijah was a man of prayer. He spent time in prayer. If we want the latter rain, folks, we're going to spend time in prayer. I'm not talking about 31 seconds to ask a blessing on our food and a blessing on the missionaries and a blessing on this and that, as we're grabbing a sandwich off the table, running out the door to get to work because we're late. That's not what we're talking about here. Elijah spent time, 30 minutes, 45 minutes, an hour, whatever time it took, Elijah spent in prayer where he was in submission to the authority of God's power. That's the kind of prayer we're talking about here. Elijah was a man subject to like passions as we are. He prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months. Was Elijah different than we are? The Bible says he was just like us. And he prayed earnestly. That's the kind of prayer that is necessary if we're going to see the the latter rain. After Elijah prayed and the rain started falling, Elijah was willing to take the role of a servant. And we read in Prophets and Kings, we read it in 1 Kings 18, that Elijah ran before Ahab's chariot and guided it all the way to the gates of Jezreel. So, folk, we need to be willing to perform needful service. Need to be willing to do that. Sometimes menial, tedious jobs seem boring, seem worthless. But the Bible says those who are faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much. I know as a parent, changing my children's diapers, helping them clean their room, washing dishes, washing clothes, helping around the house, helping with raising children. Folk, that's a great work. It's a great work. Are the tasks menial? Yeah, they are. Oh, but they're vital. They're important. They need to be done. So Elijah was faithful in the little things. Faithful in little things. So there were four things. Penitence, dealing with iniquity, prayer, and being willing to do menial tasks. Those four things, folk, will epitomize those who are preparing to receive the latter rain. Let us pray. Dear Father in heaven, please forgive us that we have not been earnest in prayer as Elijah was. And please forgive us for not being repentant and penitent as the people were there at Mount Carmel. Father in heaven, I pray that each one of us would take that time in prayer and would confess and put away all sin, that you and you alone would be seen in our lives. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.